learning flow. This video is the combined video of all the video series which come after the workshop on Python Basics. First thing, we just look into is what is Python. We don't go into that theoretical definition or so, but on normal basis, can anyone tell me what is this Python is? Don't tell me that the snake kind of thing. Just turn on your mic and tell me, or you can just type in there also. Not that bookish definition, I don't want. What according to you is, you think is Python is. Come on, turn on your mic and say what you will feel like.
I think it is just a communication language between PC and us to make some communication.
What kind of communication you mean?
Means some kind of like we want to write some code and we want to operate some kind of function. So we
made a dynamic programming language or just a programming language?
No, it's a dynamic programming language, obviously.
You just mean that kind of thing, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, others want to contribute anything? It's just a way to make system understand our instruction. Yeah, it's the basic thing that a programming language does for us. Convert our language to that machine language or the understandable binary code, 0-1 code, basically. That's a common thing what a programming language does. So yeah, it's also a programming language. You can say it is an interpreted language. Why interpreted? Whenever I'll start the coding, I will show you why it's called an interpreted one. The next thing we will see, it's an object-oriented one. As Agnivesh is here, he will just show you in details about the object-oriented part of this Python. And then, it's a high-level programming language. So why we call it as a high-level programming language? The main thing that makes us call this as a high-level programming language is that you just type in plain English. You don't need to write 0-1 code or say ASCII code or something differently that is not commonly understood by humans. So you just type in by common English and few restrictions, just kind of thing. And also, we say that Python uses dynamic semantics. Why dynamic semantics? Is basically because of that Python variables. When I'll just show you why in details a few minutes later. And then, you know, who is this guy is? Turn on mic if you need to.
He is from Netherlands, I know that.
Yeah, I have written that. Obviously, his name is also written here. Okay, he is the person who just developed Python. And for a small information, you guys, I'd like to share with you is that he developed this Python in 1989. And you guys must be familiar with Java, right? So Java is developed in which year? Can anyone tell me? 1995, exactly. 1995. And just look. Here in December 1989, Python released, like the first version or first implementation of Python started. It's for the users, not for common users, but yeah, for users. And by 1994, we got our first Python 1.0 release. So you can guys consider that after 1994, in 1995, Java came into market. Okay, so does anyone have ever thought that why Python is popular, like it became popular recently and not in that 1990s? It's much before Java came into market. But if you just look into class 12 syllabus, you will see Java is more there, right? Java or C++. Recently, some third-party libraries of Python got released, and those were too popular. Like everyone might have heard of them. Yeah, it's with the NumPy and the Pandas, and those made Python a popular so much that everyone now started learning it for the data science and all. In the timeline, by October 2000, Java releases its 2.0 version. And for everyone, 2.0 was the first version and 2.7 was the last version of Python 2. Okay, so 2.7 just discontinued on January 1st, 2020. And the current version that we use in Python is Python 3, and that's Python 3.7. Or I will be using Python 3.6 better. For the next part, just tell me why are you here for that Python, like why Python? So basically in Python, I have mentioned that it's an okay, you want to say usually code becomes small. Yeah, code becomes small, that's true. But for Linux based system or for Unix system, that's also true that code is small. And for Python, the basic reason is it don't have any compilation step. Yeah, internally it has compilation step, but for a normal user, you cannot have a compilation step. Like you can won't see the compilation step. You just see a run button or run by enter. I'll show you in details. That's the main thing that makes it also more popular for that purpose. The next thing is that the AD test and debug cycle. Like if you are more into this coding, you'll see that every time you write something, you just test it. You found that okay, it's not working properly or it's not giving the correct output, then that's the test part. And then you debug that, okay, make this for loop change or do something here. I was telling about for a C, you will remember that you just compile a code, then run it, and then again check for the output, right? But for here, you'll see that it's much faster. On a just a click of a enter, you get a output out there. And the other important thing I mentioned, it is a interpreted language. So you can see that whenever you find a bug or a bad input, then you will see that it will not give you a segmentation fault. Okay. You won't see any kind of segmentation fault. You will just see that it just throws out an exception for you in case you are just known with exception. No problem if not. It will just show you that at this point you have to fix something. Unlike C or C++, like it shows you a lots of error, like this are error. It won't do something like that. And then is that important thing that made it popular as a data science. So you can develop games, and a module called Pi Games make it much easier to develop Pi like games. Yeah, you may disagree with me that C++ is much better for developing games. Yeah, that's true. But try developing games with Python some days. Now move much more into the thing. For running a Python code, you need some basic things. And those basic things are that number one, you can run a Python code in an interactive mode. What's an interactive mode? It's basically you'll just run it on the press of an enter key, and it will just show you there and there. Like you don't need to open up some screen or something like that. That's an interactive mode. And the second thing that Python allows you is the script mode. This is much more popular if you are developing a huge thing. If you are into data science, you will just choose interactive mode as it's much user-friendly. And if you are into developing games or developing web UI or some GUI stuff, then you will simply move to script mode. So in script mode, you will find something called a .py file. You'll just write something in a text mode and then save the text file as .py. And then put that in the Python interpreter. Remember, whenever you put the file in Python interpreter, it will directly give you the results. You cannot see this intermediate step, but in the intermediate step, there is actually a .pyc file is created. Okay, so don't miss out this part that what is .pyc? That is PyPy compiled step. You can't see that file, but that is actually created. So in the script mode, you just write in .py file, a text file with extension .py, and then you will see the results. I will show you the both the modes, no problem. The next thing is the Python implementations. So for Python implementation, some of you told that you guys use Anaconda for Python, and probably some will say that they use C Python. What is the C Python? C Python is the basic Python that you download from their website. C Python is that basic thing. The next thing is the Jupyter notebooks. Jupyter notebooks are probably those that mostly use Anaconda to just run Jupyter notebooks. You have seen there if you're familiar with Anaconda. But and the last one is that IDE. So IDE is basically an integrated development environment. So whenever you will print a like open up a .py file, you will prefer using IDE. I will use PyCharm over here, but other IDEs are basically, you can say Visual Studio Code or Sublime Text, or you can use Atom for the purpose also. There may be someone who don't know what's an IDE is or what it does. It basically a software application that provides basically comprehensive facilities to you to just translate your language to computer programs. Okay, that it does. It just changes it. The next thing is the syntax. For the Python syntax, I'm just moving into the code. Okay, just if you guys come up with some questions, just drop it down or ask me. Okay. For the syntax part, one second. Okay, you guys can see a .txt file. Now look, I have written here something. Just ignore the thing. I will just describe what are this thing later on. But for the syntax purpose, just look. Python uses a syntax called indentation. Not a syntax, but it uses indentation. You can see there's no bracket, okay? There's no third bracket or first bracket for the, third bracket for starting of this. This statement is a definition of a Python function. I will describe one by one later, no problem what's written here. So you can see after an description, we just give here a colon. That's the what thing we need here. And this is a comment line. I will again show you in details how it works. Now look, after this Python description, remember the comment line is something the compiler or the interpreter ignores. You can write whatever there, but it will ignore. So this line is actually ignored by the interpreter. The next line that actually, the next line that actually comes up is this one, if statement. In that you can see a space of four spaces are there. Basically, I have used a tab for that purpose, but there's no hard and fast rule that you need to use four spaces. A minimum of one space is needed for this indentation purpose. Just look into this thing. If after the if statement, there's something under if. For that under if, you can again add four spaces up to here, or you can add as much spaces as you want, but you need at least one space. That is, You cannot do something like this. Why? Because the previous line has four spaces and you just need to add a single space here. Okay. So here single space, if you're doing this, it will give you an error. I'll show you, but just give something of this sort. Okay. You can add four spaces, no problem. Or you can add a unlimited number of spaces, but it should be something under it. Good. The next line, look, you can see it's again four spaces. This is the how indentation works. I'll show you again. Now look, this for statement goes here. I'll describe for statement afterwards. But after this for statement, there's a for within a for I have applied here. You can see I have used only one space. Understandable? So basically you just need to add a basics of one step, like a one space, and the spacing is really important. Without spacing, it will give you a lot of error. I mean, not lot of error, it will give you one error. Every time it will give you one error. And look, after the function ends here, you are just ending this with that again, that four space, that the return statement comes up in four spaces.
Sorry to interrupt. Can I ask something?
Yeah, why?
Can you? What is the third bracket? What is the purpose of the third bracket in the fourth line, like after return?
After return.
Yeah, like the fourth line return. Like, do we have to like use third bracket?
No. Just look at the last line. There's nothing.
Yeah, but okay. You put that third bracket.
Yeah, I put the third bracket because it denotes a list thing. I will explain list. Okay, don't look into the code, just look into the spacing thing. I'm just describing the spacing thing. I'll just describe everything later on. I'll just coming to one of them. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Cool. So I found that after the last return, you can see there's again four spaces. Like since I have used four spaces at the starting, so I need to do that. Fine. That's what indentation look like. You can see this is the same indented. For every time change, you need to just increase the indentation. And next, look into some of the faulty codes. Here you can see again, this is the whole code is faulty. How? I'll show you. Look, here I have used four spaces, but in the next line that comes under this function description, here I am using three spaces for that purpose. Okay. So this comes as not indented, and the first line should be at zero indented. That is the whenever you are describing a function, yes, function within a function is possible in Python, but unless it's function within a function, you just need to describe it at the zero indentation. You cannot have this much space, okay, for the first line. And for this, it's not indented since you need to make something of this sort, at least one indentation. Fine. And after the for loop, you can see it's again indented, done, it's good. But here, look, you have, I have added unnecessary indentation. Since it comes under the for loop, but I have added unnecessary indentation, it will give you an error. Again, for within a for, no problem. This statement is again not a problem, but look, this statement should be at the same indentation as this. Fine. Since it is not at the same indentation, it will give an error. So this is what this Python syntax is. Like, you need to maintain the indentation in this kind of way. So I'm using here the Jupyter notebook, and Jupyter notebook is not from as a part of Anaconda. Okay, you can use Jupyter notebook as a different thing also. This is how Jupyter notebook looks, and this is not the script mode, it's the interpreted mode. The first thing, wait, I'll just show you the other modes too. Okay, the current thing you can see here is this is the IDE mode. I am using PyCharm here. This is how that IDE works. Okay, so this is the IDE. So you write whatever you write here, and you just need to run it like this. Okay, this one run actually, no problem. So I'll just go through that Jupyter notebook and show you how this IDE works at the same time. Now look, in the previous script, you just saw there, you can say, you saw something written with this hash. Okay, so this hash is basically denotes the compiler, like says to the interpreter that it's a comment line, and whatever is written within a hash is ignored. Like the interpreter won't see whatever is written. So you can see this is the first line. You can just, for every line, you can add this way. And then I have written something within these quotes. Okay. So this doesn't become a comment. If you just run it, you can see it prints the whole statement. Okay. There are multi-line comments too. I'll just add like the end. What is multi-line comments? Like you can add multiple lines and comments. The next part is the arithmetic part. Remember the arithmetic part, whenever moving in, it's much more important for data science purpose. Okay. This is a simple thing. If you can add something of this sort, 2 + 3, it will give you the output. If you just directly move to here, you can directly add 2 + 3. You just don't need to declare variables as well. If you don't want to declare variables, you can just do 2 + 3 and then run it. So, for that, okay, you run it, and then we just need to add something here. You need to add a print statement to print here in the IDE, but not in that Jupyter notebook. You don't really need a print statement to print in the Jupyter notebook. You can see it just prints out here, but for that Jupyter notebook, now you can see that in the Jupyter notebook, you don't need to implicitly add a print statement. I have mentioned to you that there is a interpreted mode and there is a script mode. In script mode, you actually need to give a print statement so that it can print the value. And similarly, you can see it has a multiplication and negation also. Subtraction, multiplication, this whole thing works here. for the division, just tell me if you divide 7 by 5, then what will it show? I just want your answers first. Tandem, I can say, I'm not checking the text, like chat.
Did you give one?
Okay. So how, okay, so let's print. It gives something else.
Showing 1.4.
Why so? Tell me.
I mean, I don't know. Maybe kind of reason.
Okay, so in Python, there's no particular definition of, you can say float, int, float, and string. It just switches between int, float, string. So that's the reason we call it as a dynamic one. So since we do not explicitly mention that we want an integer answer of this, it will give you a float answer. Every time it will give us float answer, answer in float. Just check if you just check in this, it will give you the same. Say 7 by 5, if you run it. Yeah, it's again gives the same answer. But if you just implicitly mention that you want an integer value, if you just implicitly mention this, then it will give you one. And the similar goes for the Jupyter notebook also. If you just implicitly mention that you want an integer value of this, and it will give you one. Okay. So if you don't implicitly mention, it will just take up whatever the value is more suitable to it. You need to take care of this. This is unlike C or C++. In C, C++, or Java, you can say it's directly takes the value of integer, but here it won't take that trouble. The similar goes whenever you multiply 3 and 3.5, it will just print out a float variable. And now tell me, if you are dividing something of the sort 7.0 divided by 5, whatever it will print up, then mic's on. Anyone? Okay. Cool. Okay, then I'm just showing out the answer.
It is showing 1.4.
Since you have explicitly mentioned that you want a float variable, so yeah, it will give you a float variable. But even if you don't explicitly mention that it's a float variable, you just want a float variable, it will just give you float since you are dividing it. And next thing is the floor division. So what this floor division does, if just look into it, the floor division gives you the result that you are wanting an integer out of it. You just want that integer part. You have, in math, probably everyone learned a thing called floor and ceil of, I guess, where you have learned in integration, probably. Right, if I'm not wrong, differential integration. So in floor and ceil, you can see it will directly give you something of this sort of directly an integer value. It will cut out that float value. The next thing that we'll see is the remainder. What is the remainder? That's a property of mathematics, okay? Everyone knows, I guess. So whenever divide, it just gives out some remainder value out from there. So you can see it gives you 2, since 5 was a 5 and remainder is 2, this kind of thing. So yeah, okay, wait, I just missed out. For floor division, remember you need to say, write the division 2 times. That's the difference from others. For others, you don't have anything from any other language, you don't have anything called a floor division. Like C, C++, Java, you don't have something called floor division, but here you have this explicit one. And remainder is same like all other functions. It just all other languages. You just need to print the remainder here. Next thing is the exponent. Remember, while using C, C++, or Java, you use something of the sort. This, right? This thing, like upper arrow for marking the exponents. So here, for marking the exponents, we use 2 times term. that simple, and just move into these things. 5 to the power 2, this kind of thing. Again, that is normal exponent thing. Okay, the next thing is, tell me about here. Whenever we make an exponent of -5 to the power 2, what will come up? Please don't run and tell me, just make guesses, or let's see. Anyone want to answer or try out? Not in a computer, fine.
Okay,
I don't know.
25
is this? Or, 25? Sorry, I didn't get you.
Plus 25.
Okay.
Yeah,
-25. Okay. That's explicitly because it just execute this part and then takes the minus. Okay. For this purpose, I have shown you this in the next example. That is, you just execute -5 within a bracket, and then on that -5, execute the exponent. It will give you +25.
Okay.
The similar thing, the bracketing part, this same example you saw somewhere above here. Whenever you saw this example, no one asked me why it's 10. Okay. Cool. So somehow it's becoming 10, like 4 into 5 minus 30 minus 20, and that bracketing thing, like using brackets, this will come up some different answer, obviously, because it's executing this part. Like that's the exact rule. What's it called? BODMS, probably DMS, something like that. Okay, that was the arithmetic part. The same thing, if you just look into here, you just get same results. For that, if 7 floor division, that would give you something, again, 1, since you're doing a floor division. Okay, sorry, I just explicitly gave you. Okay. Look, this gives you 1, and other things comes here, say -5. If we just try out this thing, -5 exponent 2, it will again show you something of this sort, -25. And if you just add a bracket and run it, you could just see the same thing. Wait, yeah, it's giving 25. The main difference between that interactive mode, I mean the Jupyter notebook, and this IDE, is that you need to explicitly write this print statement. Remember that, otherwise it won't do anything. Just run it and done. Okay, tell me.
Do you have to give space before calling the sign, exponent sign?
This thing, yeah. This space.
Yes.
No problem. Got it?
Okay.
That's basically keeping it clean and clear. That's the kind of thing we give a space for. It's own. It doesn't make any problem for the purpose. Next thing is the variables. Probably you all have idea about variables. Tell me what is variable is. Come on.
Variable is nothing but a memory location.
Memory location, okay. Okay, how?
When I take a variable, it stored a place for the variable. Make a place.
It makes a place for the variable? So it makes a place for the variable, but what is variable?
Variable is something in which we can store some value, integer, string, some kind of value.
Okay. You can store values, that's quite obvious. Like, that's a correct kind of thing. So variable is something you can consider as a containers. So where you can store values. It's not a memory location. Memory location is decided by that compiler or the interpreter. It's not up to you. You cannot change the memory location. So variable does what thing? It just stores the value. But remember, in Python, there's no variable description kind of thing. Like whatever we used to do in C or C++ or Python or Java, that int a equal to something or float b equal to 5.5, right? Or string is not there in C++, okay? For this kind of thing, there's nothing. You don't need to do something of the sort. You just write some name and give a equal to sign and define its value, okay? You just did this thing. Look here. What it does, take the length as 15, you just assign the value and done. An obvious thing, you don't use a semicolon here. Don't do that. You just give a lot of errors. If you do it, it will give something of the, sorry. Okay, I need to show you in that IDE. It will basically give you an error. So it's the length and then taking the width as something as 3 into 5, and then it's printing out that length. But if you just check out that what the type of this, you have used checking type in C++ or Java, anyone? Like what the type of variable is defined? You want that? Fine. So you actually can do something of the sort like type. That's the thing. Look, what's this showing you? It's showing you something called int. Okay. Basically, you are multiplying two integer values, and the ultimate thing is also needs to be an integer. So Python describes itself as an integer, like it defines that part. Okay. The next thing is the thing I said just now, we don't need to explicitly define its type of a variable. It doesn't need any type. So whenever you just print out this thing, or just type something like, just check out the type of the variable, it will show you that it is an integer. And again, look, I have used the same variable again for defining 1 power 15, like 15.0. And again, if you just check the type, it show you it's float. Like if you just printed that length, it will just print out 15.0. And if you're just checking out the type, it will print you 15.0. Just wait, I'm just showing you something of this sort. If I just copy this. Okay. So first we define length as 15. And let's say we just check out what it actually is, what the type of length is. Remember, I use the same variable. Look the difference. Okay, every time I have printed length or what? Okay. Now I can see that the length is first defined as 15 and its type is integer. Now, if you just put type again and then length again, and then okay, it's a printing of the final statement. Wait, I'll show you. Length 15, then we're explicitly typing the print length. Okay, probably it runs, probably it won't run. Now see, first, okay, for type, again, you need to print that print statement here. So for, I'm adding that. So first you see the length is 15 as an integer. Then we printed the length. Again, we just assigned 15.0 in length. So it just took 15.0. And every time we just add this type here. Look here. Look. Yeah, first we just did this kind of thing. First print statement printing us the value and it's showing you it's an integer. Again, we're changing it to a float. It's showing you it's a float value. So you can see it's dynamic. You can actually do whatever you can you want in this variable thing. You can change it to anything. Even if you just write a string here, I'll just show you how to do that later in this part. Write a string here, say something, and if you now print it, it will show you some. Look what it shows. String, exactly. This takes up whatever value it comes. Okay. Yeah, that's the thing I didn't done here. It just prints out that values. Okay. Now, just tell me, whatever we run this statement, if we just run this statement, what it will give me? That's what. Tell. Huh? Come on, guys. That's okay. What will this say?
It will be an error.
Wait, I think others want to say anything?
It will just give the value if it is in command line, but in the ID, it will just give an error.
Yeah, it will print out a value. Yes, it will give you an error actually. It's a name error, no problem. But why it gives an error? Since you didn't define a variable in this manner.
Yeah, exactly.
In a command line also, it will give an error since you didn't define it somehow before. Okay.
I am assuming I've already defined it.
Yeah, if I've already defined it, it will give any error. But in this case, I haven't defined it anymore. So it gives me an error. That's the main reason of giving it an error. Now,
so we have a question.
Yeah, we have a question in chat.
What is the significance of type?
Significance of type. So type basically type. Gives you significance of type, right? The significance of type types gives you the like prints out what the variable is, or like if you like what kind of variable it is, like what value it is currently storing. Say since you are not explicitly defining any variable as integer variable, like integer, float, or string, so by using type you can actually check what the variable currently storing. Say you just mixed up the thing I tried to do here. First took a integer value, then assigned a non-integer value, I mean a float value to it. So slight type gives you that control, like to check what the current status of that value variable is, what it currently storing. Okay, I hope you got that.
Yeah, it is clear.
Okay. The next thing, look, I have mentioned a small calculation here. You can see it's just a division calculation, then assigning a price, then multiplying price with the tax, okay? So it's the normal process, you just calculate a tax. Now, look carefully. We have used this another operator here. It's basically a normal operator, like explicitly in Python. So what this operator does, it's the underscore operator, okay? So what it does, whenever you do something, or do any kind of operation in Python, it stores the last done operation as its value. So this stores the last done operation as its value. So currently this is storing 2.25435. Okay. So if I'm adding it with price, let's not add it first. But let me show you first this. Cool. If it is printing the value of the underscore operator, you can see it shows you what its current value is. Cool. Now, if you just add it with price, like you can use it anywhere. If you just add it with price, you can see it just adds the value. So it's a valid operator, but remember, it only uses the last value you executed. Like the last value the interpreter executed is the value it stores with it. Now if I just, now I've executed a comment list in 2 point something, now I'm showing you. It stores the 22 points that value. Fine.
Like so, a smart calculator.
Yeah, kind of a smart calculator, but it does this for only the last value is it stores there. Okay. So you cannot expect it to store the other values also. That's how it works. Next thing, this round function. So for this round function, what we are going to do, we are taking this value and then rounding off to two decimal places, like just cutting out this plus. So you guys know what rounding off is. You can see what the value comes out. So you can see the current value of this underscore is rounded up to two decimal places. The next thing, and the most important, like a cool thing you can say, is the multiple variable assignment. Here in Python, you just assign multiple variables at the same time. How? I've shown you that you are assigning A with 3.2. Okay. The value of B will be 1 and the value of C will be 6. Say I'm changing 6 to a string value. So you can see that we are assigning the three values at the same time. So if we just print three of them, it will show you as a tuple. But if you just print it one by one, it will show you one by one its values of. Cool. So I suppose it's not there in other than Python. You cannot find this kind of easy operations. Okay. But if you remember, if you print something like A comma B comma C, it gives you a tuple. That's the problem is. You just print out in this manner. Now, the next thing comes with the expressions. For the expressions, you know, it's there's a less than, greater than, not equal to, double equal to, and then less than equal to, and greater than equal to. So the same thing we can do here. It gives a Boolean results as true or false. So Boolean is also part of Python data types. But remember, C don't have Boolean. Java have Boolean. Now look what it gives out. It prints out true. So let's see what's the type here. I'm telling Boolean. So let's see what the type here. You can see it prints out bool. So the four things that Java have, like the data types, the normal data types that Java have, are that int, float, then str, not string, str, and the last one is the bool, that is for the Boolean. It prints out true and false. So the you can try out this kind of thing. Greater than, sorry, I need to move this guy. Greater than, you can try out like greater than, equal to, it just gives you something of that sort, that whether it's true and false. Remember, I'm showing you with direct values, like direct values, I'm not using any variable here, but yeah, you can try out with variables also, it will give you the same results. There's no problem with that. You can say not equal to this. Okay, now there's a question for you all. Please don't run it and tell me the answer. I don't want that running and telling the answer. Tell me, what will it print out?
Come on. It will be false.
It'll be false.
Why so?
True is basically one and false is zero.
Okay, you are just converting it to the binary and giving the answer. Yes, it will be false. Because for true, we consider a binary 1, and for false, we consider a binary 0 for the purpose.
Yes, yes, yes.
Exactly. Exactly. So these are the other expressions. There's a binary expressions, you can say. Also, Python supports something called a complex expressions. Okay. Python supports something called this complex expression. So whenever you are describing it in this manner, you can actually compare it in this manner, like A less than B less than C. So which is printout gives you true because A is the lowest, A less than B, and you can see B is also less than C. So it gives you true. Now tell me what's the question? What will this print out?
False.
False, exactly. Now, similar thing, you can just play around with it. See if whatever it gives out, like this kind of thing, or hopefully you can understand why it gives out a false. Everyone, or everyone is sleeping.
Fine. Yeah, we understood.
Okay. The next thing that I'm showing is the built-in functions. For built-in functions, I have shown here is the mean and the max. Okay. But for other built-in function you used above is the print one. Okay. Print is not here. Printed is the IDE. We use the print, we use the time. That time is a built-in function. So you didn't define the function type. It's defined in the Python itself. Another built-in function that we use commonly is the mean. So in mean, give three values, give four values, or give two values, it will just print out the mean. Or you can give something array dot mean. I'll show you what that is. And next thing, the max, it will just print out the maximum of numbers. For mean, it just prints out what's the minimum of the three numbers. Yeah, and the max is how it goes. The next thing that comes up is that compound statements. Okay, compound statement is something like we use AND, OR, and NOT for the purpose. Like this is a keyword in Python and obviously other in other languages too. So it checks the whether this part and this part is true or not. Like it goes directly with the truth table of true, false. I mean AND, OR, and NOT truth table. Hopefully you guys know what the truth table is. Yes. Oh no. Okay, no one knows. God knows. Okay, so we are truth table is something like, you guys know this kind of thing? You guys know this kind of things? No one knows?
Yeah, we know.
Yeah, so this is what the truth table is, and like on the basis of truth table, the compound expressions comes out. So since one is less than true and two is less than three, this comes out as a true. This kind of, this goes in the same manner. And again, the compound expression is there or and just look here. Just play around with it. You will see it gives up false. Why? Two greater than three comes out to be false, and one less than two comes out to be false. And that's what the truth table shows you that one true and one false gives a false. That's completely on the truth table of the AND, OR, and NOT operation. So,
okay, this is
what?
Like, can we run a program like I want numbers from max to minimum? So, can I do that?
You want numbers from max to min? So, you have limited numbers?
Yeah, like I have four numbers, like 5, 9, 99, 0. And can I have four numbers, like at least from max to min?
You want to sort them?
Yeah.
Okay, for sorting them, you need a list, not a like liquid variables. Okay. You need to store there in a series, not liquid variables. Because for liquid variables, you can find either mix or man, like either the mean or max. But for least or the array kind of thing, you can do that, obviously. Yes, it can be done.
Okay.
Now, okay, fine. You know what then, how this negation works, if it actually is true and then it comes out to be a false, and this way it's 2 less than 3 is actually a true value, and using a not before it gives a false value for you. Now everyone tell me what the output of this expression is. Come on, you can write in chat also, I'm waiting now. Oops.
Can you show us the statement, please?
As I equals 7, and then checking if I double equals 2 or not of I remainder that's mod 2 not equal to 0 and I less 1 less than I less than 5. Wait, I'm writing it in the chats also. True. How? It's true. So let's change it. Like, why it's true? Tell me. Why it's true? The output is true. Okay, I can read the output is true, but why is it?
Because in the first statement, I equals true, it checks, so it results in false. And now in the not statement, I mod 2, which is not equal to 0, it is a true value. And I means 1 is less than I and I is less than 5, which also results in true. So this whole thing.
That's false.
It's a false. No. So the OR statement, so, for that OR statement, it's true. It's not false. Not.
Okay.
We have that not statement. Nah, so as it is false, it gets true to the OR. So 1 is false.
Exactly. Okay. Yes, it's exactly right. Since this part comes out to be a true part, a false part, and then not gives a true, and I double equals 2 is a false. So false or this part gives true. So false or true gives true. And remember, this is the whole part I just shown you right now. This is the most important for the data science work in Python. Okay. There's the numerical operations and that other things. So anyone interested in that kind of thing, you need the above part most important. Like, you're just going to use this more again and again. I was working on int and float, so I was not showing you string to that extent. Now, whenever I'm going into the strings, okay. So for string, you just have two things. You can use single quotes, like here you see. Here I have used a single quote to print it. Even you can use double quotes too. But remember, you cannot use a mixture. You just need to put either single quotes or double. Of course, Python accepts both, but you cannot put a mixture. So even if you put a double quotes, Python actually reads this as single quote, so it's not your fault. It compiles that way. The next thing is the escape sequence. What the escape sequence like? If you are wanting to print this thing, doesn't. So for doesn't, you are using a single quote. Fine, you have a single quote, and you just need to print a quotation also. For that thing, we use escape sequence. That's a backslash before that. So, if you're using this, you can see it prints out the dozen exactly. But if you're not, if you just miss out this print statement, look, it just gives an error because T is something it's not defined. It will show you T is not defined. Look, T is not defined. Invalid syntax. That's because it finds out something, but it don't find a definition of that, and again it finds a start of a single code, but there's no end to it. That's how it got like it mixes up the thing. Also, for that, without using escape sequence, you can use something like that. You just use a double quote and then add a single quote in between. So it takes it don't much like it takes that as a single quote and prints it out. Okay, so yeah, that's a bypass from other languages. In Java, you actually need to give a single backslash to just print out quotes. It's not possible other way. And now look here, I tried to print something like she said. So what does she said? That's within a quotes isn't. So put the whole thing in a single quote. Put this statement that you want to print as a quoted statement, put it in a double quote within the single quote, and then put things like backslash quotes. Now look, it prints out this part. I'll just show you it in IDE. This needs a quote. Now look, in IDE you can actually see the backslash slash t is denoted as a escape sequence. It just marks that for you. Okay. Fine. Hopefully understandable how to just print out this mixture. But if you just miss out this colon, look, IDE will give you, show you that here's an error. Fine. That's if you just scroll over on an IDE, it shows a missing quote. Okay. Just print out. Run this. It gives you an error. That's syntax error. The same thing, but yeah, it gives you an error. Yeah, the same thing they tried it using the print statement. And print statement shows it like that in this manner. The next thing, like say you need to print some C address or the this kind of thing. Okay. Okay, for that, before I actually show you, there are a few more escape sequence that you actually need whenever you're coding. That's first one is the slash t. Slash t is basically giving a tab, like whenever you press a tab, it gives a space, right? Extra space. But for a code to understand that, you want to give some more spaces, not a space using a space bar. So slash t is used for as a tab. And the next thing is slash n. It's the next line command. Like whenever you're printing slash n within a print statement, it gives you, it moves the printing, like rest of the print, like rest of the statement to print after slash n, it moves to the new line. Like it prints in a new line. Well, it's like more common thing. You can find this thing in all programming languages. It's common to all programming languages. Okay, but what I told you this thing now is that, look here, whenever we are trying to print something, C colon, that's some, and then you want to give some name. Look here, slash n comes up. So whenever slash n comes up, it just prints out. Look, it takes slash n as a command, like new line command, and prints out the new statement here. Wait, I'll show you in IDE too. Fine, look, the IDE shows you explicitly that here you have a slash in mentioned here. Fine, for this purpose, you can use another escape sequence in Python that's basically an R. So what this R does, if you are familiar with the coding in CMD or moving like exploring CMD, like command prompt, like working out with command prompt, not clicking here and there. So you must be familiar with using this R. This is actually an escape sequence that says that whatever string is after that, print that as a string. Fine. So it actually ignores all the whatever you have done here. Say you have written something slash this, everything is printed as a string. So whatever you write here, it takes it as a string. Now if I just print it, you can see it takes it as a string. That everything is got printed. But if you just miss out this R, you can see it just notices there's a slash n mentioned, there's a there's a colon mentioned, and there's a slash t mentioned. So if you just do in this manner, so you can see it takes the first part, takes a slash n, prints a colon, prints the quotation, and then takes a slash t, that is a tab, and then prints the rest. Fine. So R is basically a escape sequence that gives the print a command that you need to ignore whatever is after that and take the whole thing as a string. Many times whenever you are changing changing directory in CMD, if you are just have experience with that, so you like CD, then a directory name. So you can find that CD, after that a directory name gives you some errors. So you can use R in that purpose also. That's a side tip, ignore if you are not familiar with it. No problem.
Achha, hello.
Yep.
We can also use double backslashes, yeah.
Double backslashes? Yeah, try out.
Sorry. No, I tried out, I'm just saying.
Yeah, you can use double backslashes also, like you want to do this thing, right?
Yeah.
Exactly, it works fine too. That it takes this, like this is again an escape sequence that shows exactly that shows that the next element needs to be printed as it is.
Yeah.
Okay, but without using double braces, say you have a larger name, say you have something of this sort. Right. I'll just do it. Say a larger path. You mean what I say?
Yeah.
This kind of thing. You just go on giving double backslashes the whole thing, or just add an R in between.
It's hard to recognize, I know. I'm just asking.
Exactly. The next thing that we move on is that string literals. So what this string literals does, look here, we are multiplying 3 with UN, okay? And then after this multiplication, we're adding UM. Fine. So it will just print out UM 3 times. And then add EOM, So this is a kind of interesting thing that you can do with strings. You can just multiply, if you need to do same things multiple times, you can just multiply this kind of thing. Say this. The next thing, okay, so the thing was that you can use it in this kind of way. You can simply multiply strings and add it with another. The next thing is the concatenation. For the concatenation, you can see I have already shown you how to do concatenation. You just add it to string. For that purpose, say you just have pi as a string and you have a thought as a string. So you just add pi to the prefix as a variable prefix, and then with the variable prefix, you're just adding thought. Then you can see it will just show you the whole string. Okay. For the string, you can do it in this manner. And yeah, it don't create a new memory space. It just adds the new memory space. Now, the most important part in string is whenever you are using C and probably C++ also, but you are using a string as a array, not a string how we use here, right? And that purpose, if you just look into like string here is also defined as an array. You can use it as an array too. You can use it as a normal variable. You can use it as an array. Remember, there's nothing called array in Python. There's something called, we call it as something else. But yeah, after the, like, you don't know what that is, I'll tell you. But before that, you just know, you can use it as an array. Now, if you just print array of 0, so it will definitely give you the 0th value. And wait, I'll just show you this chart first. Whenever you are doing something with string, remember that it starts with a 0th element, that the way array element starts at 0. And similarly, it ends at length minus 1, and length is the maximum value you can go up to. But in Python, there's an interesting thing is, after this much, the selected part is there in every language, okay? But Python has something more for you. That's minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. Like you can go in reverse order too. In array is like in array, you can go in reverse order. Okay, how? First say Okay, first if you just written here, so I'm just printing it. So like whenever you're printing array of 5, it's just printed out the last elements in 0 to 5, and the length is the 6. So 0 to 5, this kind of thing. Now, if you just print out array of minus 1, array of minus 1 actually gives out the last element. Okay? Array of minus 1 is the last element. So Python has this, you have that opportunity to print something like last element directly with the minus 1. But in Java or C, we used to do something like traverse from past and reach the last element and print that same way. Word of 5, like array of this statement is the user statement that you use everywhere, but you have this privilege to using minus 1 here. The next thing comes is that minus 2, minus 6. But remember, what's minus 6 does? The total length is 6. So what minus 6 does? Look, it gives a P. So it starts in this manner. This one is the minus 1 element, then minus 2, and this is minus 6. So whenever you are traversing from front end, there's some. It starts from 0 till length, like length minus 1. And while you are traversing from reverse order, it's basically minus 1 till negation of length, right? Like you actually print till 0 till 5, and in reverse order is minus 1 till minus 6. I hope you can understand that part. The next thing is slicing. For slicing in Python, it's much easier than C, C++. How? You just print it with colons. Like you just want, for Java, if you guys, anyone know, you use substring. Okay. Probably you guys know or not, no problem. And for C, you just print till array is born, like you just make an array and store it in another variable kind of thing. But here, you can directly do it in this manner, like 0 till 2. Till 2 means not 2, less than 2. How? Only py. The word was Python, fine. So the first two elements, like 0 and 1 in place, are getting printed 0 till 2. The next thing I'm just showing is this thing, 2 till 5. So py 0 till 2. Now 2 is inclusive and less than 5. So tho, and the last element was n, that is the fifth position n, 0 till n. So this, except the fifth position, it just printed out the rest. Okay. The another thing is, if you want everything till the end value, which is you don't want to put any front value or the like starting, you don't want the starting value, you want the interpreter to start from the very beginning. Okay, you don't want to explicitly mention that. So you just give a colon and write the value. Done. It gives you the same thing. That is, you did something like 0 till 2 and colon 2 is the same thing. And then you want something like from 4 till the last. Now, wherever it ends, you want to say something?
Hello.
Yep. Tell me.
Please repeat this. Yes, slicing strings.
Okay. For this slicing, whatever we are doing, we are just taking 0, like the starting element. Okay. So it's basically like the variable name, say variable name. And then you are taking a starting element, say starting element, you are giving a 0, or maybe another starting element, and starting element, then you give a colon and give a ending element. Fine. So you just define it in this order. First starting element, ending. Remember, it's always less than the ending element. Fine. Like it runs always less than the ending element. So it won't print the ending position element, but it will print just the value less than that. Fine. So whenever you are doing 0 till 2, it gives you py. Why so? Here, the position p is at position 0, then y is at position 1, and t is at position 2, right? Just look into this chart. P is at position 0, y is at position 1, and t is at position 2. So it prints less than t. So position 0 and position 1. Got it?
Yeah.
Yeah, the similar goes here also from 2 till less than 5. Okay. Mm-hmm. And in the third one, if you explicitly know that you are starting from the beginning, fine, you know you are starting from the beginning, and you know wherever the value is, you want to start from the beginning. So there's no need to explicitly mention zero. Since you know you are starting from the beginning, you just start. That is, you just mention here colon 2. So what it does is starts from the beginning, prints till less than 2. So everything remains same. The whatever I have said here, the everything remains same in this purpose too. But it does it, it prints, you are not explicitly mentioning the starting element. Okay, that you are not explicitly mentioning that 0th position is starting element. Say you are wanting to print in this manner. Oops. Now look. What if this is 1 till 4. Fine. Now you don't want to mention the starting element. That is, you want it to start from the very beginning. So leave this blank. If you leave this blank, it will start from the 0 and run till less than 4. Fine. Similar is the this case. If you want it to print till the end, like you don't want to explicitly mention that end here, you want it to end where the string ends. So you just mention its starting position now, give a colon and give the ending position as blank. Fine, you are not mentioning any ending position, so it will run till end, like 4, 5 and 6, fine, all the values. Similar is the case. Minus 2 colon nothing. Tell me, what will you do?
It will be ON.
Yeah, again ON, since it will just print out the negative value, like it will start from the negative part and then print the negative value. That is similar to the 4 commas nothing. Okay. Now, you can do something of this sort. Say you are adding nothing till 2 and then 2 till end, like first till 2 and then 2 till nothing. It's actually the same. It will print out this
Python.
Yeah. Okay, so if you just changed out that, if you just print till 2 from starting till 2 and then ending like 4 till the end, like you want to miss out the middle two elements, like position at 2 and position at 3, then you can do it easily here. You just you don't need to run any for loop till search the whole array and go in that manner. Okay, that's how it works here. Now say the word has like what was there in word Python. So it has 6 positions. What will happen if you just print out something want to print something at the position 42, like the 42nd position? It will print out what? Tell me. It will give an index error since it's out of index. In Java, you remember this array index out of bounds, and yeah, in C you can get a garbage value, but it will show you index error. Fine. The next thing is, again, if you just print out 4 till 42. Now look, why? See that if you're just trying to print out the 42nd element, it gives an error. But if you just print out a slice that 4 start from the 4th position and end till the 42nd position, okay, so it gives you something. It doesn't give you any error as the previous case. It is because it runs till the end and then it finds that the value is not there, so it finds something to print out, it will do for you. Okay, It won't give you an error explicitly, since you can just concatenate again and again. It knows that you can do something of that sort, but whatever it has currently in hand, it just print it out. Okay, it don't find that, okay, this value is not there. Doesn't matter. It's not there, not there. It won't mind. Fine? Understandable? I'm guessing yes. Yeah, the next part is that you are printing a slice of 42. Till the end from the word Python. Okay, look what it gives. It gives a blank character. Why? Since at the 42nd position there's nothing, right? Why it gives you an index error? since the index, the string index is out of range. The range is only 6 characters out of range. But in string, if you're printing a slice, then what is there? You are starting from 42th position and till the end. So it will have nothing, basically, right? It's a blank, right? You can imagine that there's nothing there. You are asking it for a slice and it finds nothing is there. So it gives out nothing. But when you are asking explicitly a position value, that give me a word at 42, that 42nd element, I need the 42nd element. So it gives an index error. Why? Since it finds that there's nothing and that particular position is nothing for him to print. But when you ask him for a slice, slice needs to be a string. Okay. Slice, when you're asking for this slice of from him, he finds, again, he finds that there's nothing. So at the 42nd element, it finds nothing and continues till the end. So end is has already, it has already encountered end before. So it will find us blank space. There's nothing present. Similar way. Actually, it handles this kind of way. Like whenever you miss out something, it handles on its own that, yeah, there's nothing there and it's a blank space. But whenever you are explicitly asking him for to show the 42nd element, okay, so there's nothing. It stores, gives an index error, like you have mentioned a wrong index. Hopefully you understand. Yeah, I'm taking it as a yes. Fine. Next, the thing you need to remember is strings are immutable. Why and how? Look, if you are explicitly mentioning that word at 0 as J, so what is word at 0? Word at 0 was something called P, right? And you are explicitly mentioning that word at 0 is J, like you are assigning the value. Fine. Now look what it says. It says it's a type error. Why? That's the reason. Strings are immutable. You cannot change values in this manner. Like you cannot say that this particular string is this, right? You're going to do this in this manner, saying strings are immutable. You cannot change the value where and here. Like you need to assign it to a new string. If you want to do this, then cut the rest slice out, take the first string and concat with the rest slice. You can do in this manner. Wait. J, then plus, and then you want say word one till end. Fine. Now it took it, like it actually, if you search out like find out the reason, it actually makes another variable. Like in it, you don't see such variables name, but it assigns it to another variable. It says word is never changed. Even now, after that, if you print this word at 0, you will find it's P. Why so? Because you cannot change the string in this manner. Okay, strings one assigned are immutable. Fine, you cannot change the each value. Like you misspelled, you need to change it in a different way. Yeah, the same thing goes here. If you want to add this thing to till end, you want to change it to pi, it won't do it. It will give a type error. And the same thing I told you, that j then 1 till end, it will give you the j y t h o n. And yeah, the first thing, it will take whatever till 2 and then adds with pi. Okay, so you can make this kind of like string, create new strings in this manner, but not using slicing like this kind of thing. You cannot assign it, since strings are immutable. Remember, immutable and mutable thing are again going to come back soon. Now, in in Java, you can say that there's a function called, in string class, there's a function called length, okay? That helps us to find out the length of a string. The similar is here, that if there's a string, okay, if there's a string, say something is written, and then you can find length s, So what Linux gives you? Linux gives you the exact length. Remember, for length, it is from 1 till length. It's not 0 till length. Linux returns you the exact length. But if you need to access a variable, you need to access it with length minus 1. Is it understandable? Okay, you can see if you print out the length, it gives out the whole length, but it actually ranges from the thing I was telling, from 0 till 33. That is the array length. That is the if you use it in this manner, so this is the length, but the length is 34. Fine. Next, the built-in function. In the beginning, you have seen that I have used a function called int and brackets. Remember? I have just moved to ID and shown you a int. I just converted whenever I was showing you the division. I just shown you something int called it. So this is again a built-in function. What it does, I have shown you int. So int does is converting any value to its integer value. Okay, now here you are seeing string str. Str is a built-in function that converts to string. So tell me, if you're converting str to and two, so what will give you? So this str is the function that converts to string. Okay, so what will it give you? What do you guys think? What will it give you? I'm not looking into the chats if you're writing there. Anyone? Okay.
Check the chat.
I guess chat. You're not writing in chats. Huh?
Check the chats.
What's that? Two as a string? Yeah, two as a string, exactly. It just prints in string. That's it, this kind of thing. Yeah, someone wrote in chat, I just saw. And the similar goes if you're converting from float to string, it just give it a similar thing. Remember one thing, if you're kinding, like doing something of this sort, say something here, so any what will it give you? You saw that convert error, expected an error, and yes, it's an error since int once an value as an integer value. Now all the primitive data types are over. You learned about boolean, you learned about integer, you learned about float, you learned about int, float, boolean, and string. Fine. Now, what I'm going to look into is the non-primitive data types. The first one is the list. What is list? The basically whatever you came to know as array in other languages is basically a list. We call it as list in Python. Exactly like almost similar to each other. Like list and array are actually similar, but yeah, there are some small differences. The similar way you can like assign a value here, okay? If you just print out the value, you'll find a list is getting printed out. The same goes for the slicing, that is from zero. If I need to print out the zeroth element, I just told you in the string that how slicing works, and it's actually a similar thing. So squares minus one, like whenever printing minus one, it just takes the last element. The same thing. If I'm printing minus three till the end, it just takes minus one, minus two, and then minus three from minus three till the end. Next thing is this one. This one is like you are not mentioning where to start and where to end explicitly. So it will consider that it will start from the beginning and end at the proper ending. Okay. So it will print the whole array, like whole list. Fine. If you just do something of this sort, tell me what it is. Okay. Just gives you this thing. But if you write the If we're just writing something, of this sort here. So the thing is, this is a mutable. So whenever you are adding it, whenever adding as a square, so you can see that it's get added. Okay. Sorry. Yes. Oh, wait, I need to run this once more. So whenever squares with this, you are adding something here. But if you print squares, you see it's the original string itself. And since the value isn't get updated here, okay. But you can add it like unconditional. Sorry.
If I want to print in the reverse list, then what I do?
I didn't get you properly. Can you repeat again?
If I want to print in the reverse list, then what I do? 25, 16, 9, 4, 1, then what
okay.
I do?
Okay, you want to print in reverse order, right? Okay, for reverse order, there's actually a function for this purpose. I think I have mentioned it. Yeah, I have mentioned it in last, but yeah, I'll show you. Come, I'm coming to that part, okay? I have mentioned it. I will go into Google then. So, next thing, the list are immutable. So if you're doing something, what's this? Okay. I don't know what I did here. Yeah. So you can actually replace values. I don't know why I just wrote it here. Okay. So what you are doing, if you want to do something of that value, say CU cubes, you want to do cubes of 0 equals say cubes of 0, 1, 2, 3. Say you want to make the changes to cubes of 3 as 64. Fine. Now look, you made a changes, then wait, I need to print the cubes also. Fine. The changes are visible here. Like if you want to make the changes, but in string, remember, you cannot do this. You cannot explicitly change a single value. Okay. But in list, you can do this kind of thing. You can explicitly change the value and work on it. So after replacing, if you just print here, yeah, it's there. Next, say it's a list of strings. So it contains a lots of strings. String elements, okay, not string list as an element is here. So it is printing out that, but I want to make change in 2:5, like 2 from here till here. We want to make the changes that we're making it a caps, okay? So if you just make the change, since it's mutable, you can see the difference. It just got to capital letters. Fine. That's how the mutable functions works. Like string list is mutable. String is immutable. Remember the difference. Again, if just you want to make this as a blank, okay, there's someone when I was showing the syntax, there's someone asking me what are this, okay, the third brackets, whether you need or not. So third brackets are basically that list part, okay, it's for that list. And if we're making the changes that from 2 till 5 should be what this null. We're not getting anything, but you are saying it should be null value. That is from 2 till 5 will be null. Now, let's print it out. You see, those values are gone. Again, if you just want to print the this statement, what it does, it makes the whole list as null. Since you haven't mentioned explicitly any starting or ending value, it takes it as a whole value. So after the printing out, it gives you the null value, right? Then comes the built-in functions. Look, for list, there's called len. Remember, for string, you have also used the function called length. Exactly, there's length for, you can use length for every purpose. Fine, it will just, it is print out the len. Remember, for working with it, you want to add position 0, 1, 2, and 3, but total length is 4. Next thing, It's basically nested. You have heard of 2D arrays, like 2D arrays is what you are just adding like another dimension to that array. So similarly, in Python, we call it a nested list. That is a list within a list or similar way. Look, yeah, this you can consider this as 2D array actually for this nesting part. Look, what it does, it just put this array and this array within a single array x. Okay, now if you want to print out x of 0, okay, what will it print? If you just want to print out x of 0, it will print the whole first row. You just mentioned a row, it will print out the whole row. Fine. Since you can use it as a 2D array, you can print out x of 0, 0. Okay, x of 0, 0 will print out the first element. That is, it goes to 0. First zero will ask it to go move to the first array. The next zero will ask it to move into the first element. Okay. So whenever printing x of 0, 0, only the first element gets printed out. That's the difference. So if we write x of 2, it will give out index 0. Why? 2, 2, 0, 1, 2. Okay, fine. Let's reduce it. So actually 2 should work. 2 no, 2 won't work actually. 1 2 would work. 1 2. Got it? It will just print out the exact the 3 out here. Okay. Just tell me, like I have a question for you. Can you tell me anything? I'm not looking at the chat. Okay. The question says, nested list comes up a lot in programming, so it needs a lot of practice. But which index would you just include after X to get C? I have actually shown you how to get 3. Tell me how to get C. I'm not looking at the chat if you're writing this there.
Has it
yet? 02. Fine. Yeah, actually 02. Exactly. Yeah, fine.
I already muted.
Yeah, fine. Okay. The next thing is the list object. Okay, now I'll move to one and one object. Is that in list what you are doing, say Beatles is a list, name of a list, and it contains this two as its parameter or as its value, and you want to add George after Paul, like you just want to add it. So we use a object method or a method that is Beatles dot append. So what append does is adds George after like at the end of the Beatles list. Okay, now look what Beatles look like. Let's see that George gets added to it. Now, say we are defining another list Beatles 2 that has this two things, say John, Paul, and George, and you want to append another list to it. Here we appended a single value. Here we want to append another list. Fine. So whenever we want to append another list, now look what it gives. Fine. It takes it as a list. That is, the fourth element is actually a list. So you can actually write print out something of, you know, say 1 and 0, 1, 2, 3. You can actually print out this. To print out this value, you just need to use a double array, like a nested array, okay? Like it happens whenever you want to add a add a whole string, like add a whole list using append. It just takes a whole list and adds it in the fourth position or the defined position. But if you want to do something of that sort, that you want to do this, you want this list to be there as a single value. That is, it should extend up to 5, not up to 4. Okay, so we use extend. That's not append. Append using Yeah, append just adds that value, and extend just takes all the list and that extends the value. So this way it goes. What's the difference between append and extend?
Append is used to add the value in the list.
Yeah. And extend is basically use it when you are adding a whole list like to another list, and you want to make it a single list. Okay. That's it. Next thing is the index. Say you have fine. So the thing is index. So what index does? Index actually checks out that searches for this particular value that you are looking for and looks if the value is there in the particular list or not. And if the value is there, it is printed out the exact position. Remember, the position is here printed out as 2, since you can see it's at position 2 since position starting from 0. Okay, say you are wanting to search something like this. So this is not there in list. What if this give you a value error? Since it's not in list, look, just don't be afraid of what's written here and there. Just go. It says geo is not in the list. That's a proper definition you will get here. Unlike C++ that, okay, something happened and you don't know what happened. Okay. Now, next thing is count. What count does, it actually counts the number of appearances. Now, in this list, you can see that John is...
Can you please repeat the index part once more?
Yeah, what? So what index does, please turn off your mic once. Yeah, fine. What index does, it just finds this particular value that you are searching for. It finds it and prints the value, like prints the index value, like where it is stored. Say if you're using something of Beatles, if you're using something of this way, Beatles 2, okay, so what will it print? It will print George. And that's what index does. Fine. It just find out, like helps you to figure out what the exact position of that particular value is. Say if there's a list of 10,000 elements and you don't know whether the a particular element where it is located. Okay. So you can use index for that purpose and figure out, okay, this is located at this position, and say you need to perform an operation on that, you can do in this manner. So index helps in just figuring out what the location of that object is. Then understandable. Who asked that? Fine.
Yeah,
fine. The next thing where you would use is count. This is also a what is this? Okay, this is also a method of list. What count does, it counts the number of occurrences of the particular object you are searching for. So if in this current list there's only one occurrence, so it will print out one. But in case there were more occurrences, so you would have seen that. Look, it will print out one since there's one occurrence. Let's say I'm just changing it over here. Okay, just print it out. Look, Stuart and John came at the last again. Fine. So if you just now run the count operation, you see it will show you the two times count. So it, it found John as twice. And if same goes for Stuart also. The next thing is remove. Remember, we have two occurrences of Stuart here. Fine. So whenever you use this remove, it shows something good. It just deletes the first occurrence. Okay. The next occurrence remains as it is. So just the first occurrence is is deleted from the list as remove. We use extend and append for adding to the list, and we use remove for deleting from the list. Okay, but for remove to just work, you have to remember that it must be there in the list. Say we have want to remove something called ST, and obviously that's not in the list. So it will say list.remove X that you given as a XT, X is not in list. Okay. This way it works. Next thing is pop. So if you have the concept of stack and queue uses something called stack uses something called pop. What is that pop is? Pop basically removes the topmost element of a stack. That's up to the stack concept. But come to the list. In list, what pop does, it also removes the last element. Look. It just not removes, basically print. Sorry, I got it wrong. It prints the first it is. I just need to do that. Since John is there at the first and last element both. One second. So change done, fine. Low it pops the last element. Look. What it does, it not only pops, remember, it just removes the last element too. If you just print here once what buttons now contain, you can see buttons contain the last element got removed. Okay, that's how the that's how the pop works, that the last element in the list will be printed and removed from the list. But if you are doing remove, what remove will do? It will remove the first occurrence of that object, and remove will ultimately print out, like if you print the array, like we're printing out this array again, but remove actually don't prints out anything. It just removes the last, the first occurrence of that particular character. But what pops does, beetle.pop, like the list.pop, it does, it removes the last element, whatever it is, it removes the last element and prints that out. Okay, that this element is removed. Say you want to insert, okay? You want to insert something not at the end, like whatever we've done with extend or append, we just inserted at the end, right? But you want to insert something at some position. Say after position one, you want to insert this Ringo. So you just do something of this sort, list.insert. Look. At position one, it gets inserted. Okay. This way the insert function works. Hopefully you guys can understand. Okay. The next thing is the reverse. Okay. Someone asked that how will you print that in the reverse order? So that's obviously single function list.reverse. Forget about for loops. Yeah.
I asked this question.
Yeah. I hope you got this clear. Like you forget about for loops or printing it in reverse order, just do it list.reverse, and here it is. You can see the whole list got printed in the reverse order. Remember, this is actually happened on list, like a new list is not created here. So the whole list, the actual list got this value reversed. Okay, not a new list on another list got this value. The total list value got reversed. So the next thing is list.sort. What is sorting does? Say if the list is of numbers, then you could have easily said that, okay, sort would do something of this order, that sorting from ascending order or descending order, right? But what this sort does, it actually arrange in ascending or descending order, but whenever it's a list of strings, like you find that it is a string value, not integer value, so it will sort it in alphabetical order. Look, the whole thing sorted in alphabetical order. This is a task for you, okay? Just tell me what will happen if beetles.extendBeetles is executed. Tell me. And the second one also, what will happen if beetles.appendBeetles is executed? Okay, should I need to check the chat, I think?
No answers yet.
Okay, no problem, I'll just check it. Anyone? What do you mean, beetles.extendBeetles? Why? Okay.
It will just it will just add beetles again.
Yeah. It will just extend, it will just keep like double elements at the end. But what will happen if beetles.appendBeetles?
It will be another list inside it.
Exactly. At the last position, it will be another list. That will be shown. Just try it out, boy. I need to print beetles too. Okay, actually the length got longer, I think. That's why it printed in this manner. No? Or what? Okay. Okay, now look, you can see that the Beatles, like the whenever we put it, append, it just came here like in this manner. In this happens for that Jupyter notebook, it prints out extra values, like it's just printed dot, 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 dot.
It will happen on the shell as well.
Yeah, not in the IDE. Mm. It does, it works. Okay, so the first non-primitive data type is the list, and that's over now. So the next one, so list was mutable, string was immutable. Good. Next thing is tuples. Tuple is basically something you just add in the, like, not as a third bracket list, like list is the using third bracket and tuple is using second brackets. Okay, that's what tuples does. And next thing goes is the tuples are immutable, so you cannot change the values. Okay, it will give you an error if you just change try to change the values of a tuple. Okay, so here, look, if you just try to change the value, it says tuple does not support item assignment. Once is you have defined it here, it's done. You need to find some other ways to add tuple or something. Okay, the similar thing, if you just print out tuple one, it will just show you the similar thing. It goes same as list and string. But remember the string list was defined in third brackets here. Okay, but in list we have also used third bracket to denote the item value. Okay, this is this statement is actually similar to list. Like looking at this particular statement, you cannot say that it is a tuple or a string, fine. But if you know this declaration that it is a tuple or a string, you can find out. Also, you can find out in something of this manner, say type t would give you a tuple. So if you find out what is the type of that variable, you can find out that, okay, it's a tuple. But for this kind of thing, like whenever you are just looking at t within third brackets one, a position value is given, that's impossible to actually figure out that whether it's a tuple or a string. Fine. The next thing that goes, The next thing is the slicing. This works in tuples too. You just put in a colon and give a starting position, ending position, whatever. This works in tuples too. So there's a least difference with list. But now let's convert a list to tuple and a tuple to list. So you have a list, okay. And in that list, you just want to convert it to tuple. Okay, this is the thing you just need to know before tuple is that what is tuple? So where is the tuple came, right? So basically tuple is a collection of like ordered and unchangeable. You need to remember this part that it's ordered and you cannot change it. For you can change in list, you can change the position since list are mutable, right? So you can change the position in list, but for tuple, once it's a tuple, you cannot change it. And you can change the order also. Okay, that's like valid point in tuple. That's the difference in tuple and list. You can change the order in list, right? You can just slice the first part, add at the end, this kind of thing. It will work, but since you cannot do the changing the order in list in tuple, fine. So converting to list is that just take a list, just put like the similar way we converted a string to integer or integer to string. The similar way goes here, the converting from tuple to list. The next thing is comes up with the least, like converting. Look, it was a list with third brackets, and whenever you print converted it, it became a tuple. Fine. Again, if you just want to convert it back to list, it becomes a list. The next thing is that membership testing. Like if a value is there in tuple or not. So for tuple, it's easy to check. For list, what do you use to check? This whether a value is there on the list or not, we just got the index. You can say index can help you whether a value is there or not. Also, but the index won't give you a true or false value, but if it's not there, it will give an error message. So in that way, you can check it out in list. But in tuple, it's much better. Say there's a tuple described in this way, and then you have B, like that the element you are searching for, and just look into in tuple, in this variable. Done. This will actually give you a true false value. Okay. And also not in. In is a keyword, remember. Look. This works in this method. You can check the membership, but for that list, you cannot check the membership. Whether you can check the index, whether index comes out or not, or it gives an error. But yes, you can check the membership in tuple. There comes a difference, like creating another non-primitive data type. That's the basic thing of tuple. While the rest is goes the same, okay? Like the whatever the functions you have done, like functions are not there, but the rest can be done. Like tuple is basically used for checking the membership and making it immutable. Since using this is mutable, using list is mutable one, and you can change the values. So in tuple you cannot change the values. Also, one more thing, the tuple like the similarity is that the negative slicing -1, -2 is goes great with that, and the rest is the similar with list. Okay. Now tell me, what would happen if you run in list in list? True or false? Now tell me.
True. And someone says true.
Fine. Oops. So if you run list in list, now, what is it expect giving you? In the nested list, okay. Remember what you encountered? It gives you the false value, since you are finding list, that is a total thing in list. It will give you a false value. Just think back. I'll just discuss it at the end. Okay, I'll just leave it as of now. I'll just surely discuss it with you. But if you can find out the reason why it list in list, okay, this is an interesting part. The next part we'll just move in is dictionaries. So what are dictionaries? Forget about Python dictionaries. Tell me, what are dictionaries? Forget about this programming dictionaries. Other, what a dictionary? Or what is a dictionary? Anyone? Don't be so dumb. Please don't be so dumb. No one knows what is a dictionary is.
The place where we find the word meanings.
Yeah, exactly. The dictionary is like, so how you define a dictionary? Just forget about this Python and think that original dictionary that the definition goes. So you just figure out something, a word, and then you find out some values with it, a meaning, that's a value, right? So that's how you can say a dictionary work. You have like, you don't have 2-3 list or 2-3 nested list, but you have a you just figure out a word, and then you find out the meaning with respect to it, or the other definitions or whatever details are giving. So dictionary in Python is the same thing. How? Say you're defining a dictionary, it goes with the third bracket. Okay. So in third brackets, just look, you just define a name, consider it as the word in your dictionary. Okay. And then you are defining a tuple here, or maybe a single value, or maybe say you are defining a meaning of that particular word, fine. Say you have defined a word here, and then you are defining the meaning here. This is what the dictionary does for you. The exact dictionary, don't mess it up with Python dictionary. Keep it simple, okay? You are defining a dictionary, say this is the Oxford dictionary, say, and then in the dictionary there is a word called France, and say there's a in the dictionary, one side of word has written something called it has a capital as Paris and with the population of this, okay? So in this description, that's how a dictionary is defined. Maybe it may not give you this additional information, or may give you some more additional information, but that's what it does. Okay. So define a dictionary. It defined. Then is this word to add something to the dictionary. Okay. Look. Wait, is this actually? So what it does that you told that capitals of say a fellow Nigeria equal to Lagos and with its population say. Okay. So similar way, if you just in a dictionary, you just want to find this word Nigeria, and then you just figure out, okay, it has a capital there. That's the way you define a dictionary, and that's the way you define it here. Remember, you don't index it with 0, 1, 2. You index it with this value. In dictionary, you index with the English alphabet, right? In an English dictionary. And the similar way goes here. You index it with the exact values. So you can try adding 2-3 countries to it, no problem. But now look, if you just want the capital of France. So say you have entered, we have defined it in the beginning. You have entered this and then, it gives you the values. It just is basically like you just told the computer, hey, I want to know the capitals of Paris and its description. It just gave you that one. It's basically a search engine kind of thing, you can say. Like if you're doing this particular statement, it's more like a search engine kind of thing, directly gives you the value. Okay, so dictionaries are basically that exact thing you see in the real life. The name goes same with that. Now, look at this thing. We described Nigeria as a capital, having a capital of Lagos and with some population. Now, we're describing again as Nigeria and capital is Abuja and some population. So, what happened? The dictionary value got updated. Cool? Look into this carefully. It's like a important part here. We don't update it with some previous concepts. Like how do you update a dictionary, like a list, or you can update a list, but you cannot update a tuple. You cannot update a string. But now look, you are updating two values at the same time to a dictionary. So you can understand where you can use a dictionary basically. Now, if you just print out the length gives you length of two because it has two keywords, the France and Nigeria. It only searches for these words. It has no understanding of what you have written here. Whenever you search for this value, it gives you the value. Look, in you can just think of list as a dictionary, as an example, okay, don't confuse. Just think of a list as a dictionary. So in a list, the position value 0, 1, 2, 3 is the finding value. That is, you are considering this part here. And the values in the, like it's stored at the position is this part, okay? So you can consider it in this way. Cool. Next thing, in list, you have seen that item dot list dot pop. So what it does, it just popped out the last element, right? But now you are using the same thing, but we are using like here in dictionaries, you need to use the function as like dictionary name dot pop item. It's the same thing. Okay, you can see that it had printed out the last element, the last element in that dictionary, and now the dictionary is one item less. The last item got removed. Okay. Next thing is list comprehension. Okay, for x in range 1 till 11 numbers, like you are adding each element to the list numbers. How? By x, and defining, like saying to the Python interpreter that for each x in range, you are giving it this x, and now you're telling for each x in the range 1 till 11. Okay, so wait, what do we do? Okay, I need to print it here. 1 second. I'll just shift to the rest part below. Now look what it does. Look, the numbers that I got created. Fine. Got it. Like how you did the whole thing in actually one single line. Guys, disclaimer for this part. If you're trying to do it in one liner, remember the errors will be great. Like if you do some errors, you'll just figure out how great the errors were. Okay, that's a disclaimer. And you'll just figure out if you just make some mistakes in doing one liner, you will need hours to actually figure out why you did the mistake. So personal suggestion, go for that long process, not this one liner. But yeah, one liner good if you're trying to reduce the Python code length. Fine. Next thing, again, we're saying, say, x in range, for x in is 1 to 11. That was what it, we did here. Now, we can do it in this manner. For x in, not range, we simply say the list. So what happened here? Say, it just take each element from this list and print, like put it as a x, like for x in this list, for each element will be taken and this x will be added to these numbers. Got it? Also, you can say, you can, if you just store this value in some variable called list, L-I-S-T, then you can just say like for x in list or for x in some other name, and you can do in that manner. Okay, what I was telling you, let's show it. Suppose you have something called. Now, if you just do it in this manner, LIS, this will also work for you. Fine. The next thing that comes up is this kind of assignment. Numbers equal to, just directly assigning. Okay. That's like normal assignment operation. The next thing, I was just trying to print out, say, x squared. So just for x in range this and print x squared. Okay, this is the normal, look, every square terms get printed out. So we'll use it here. Squares, you are assigning a squares as x into x for x in range 1 to 11. So what it does is just takes the squares. Say I just insert another cell below and add it. It for you. Now look, whenever we're looking at the squares, you can see it got converted into a list. Yeah, and yeah, similar way we can do here. Look, x square in range, also x square in list, then squares equal to this 1, 2, 2 of 4, or like in multiplication form, and continuing this matter, also squares equal to, okay, this thing, look. I'll just replace it here so that I can show you. Fine. What happened here? Here, you just assigned it in this manner, okay? Like dot, dot, dot. So it's an invalid syntax, remember. That's why I just copied it and shown it to you. Now, again, if I just copy it and show you, you'll see what the value is. Look, it works fine. Okay, so you cannot do something of this sort here, but you can definitely do this three processes, no problem. Okay, I think, wait. No, 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 you cannot do it. Wait one second. This is. Don't work actually. Yeah, it don't work. That was the thing. Now look, in one liner, the complexity comes. Say a odd square. You were just trying to add a form a list with odd squares. How? You're taking squares for I in range this, then you were giving a condition that if x mod 2 not equal to 0. Okay? Look, the one liner works so good here. Look, you just formed a list with a one liner description and given out like x square x into x, and then for x in range this, and then you just given out if x in x mod 2 equals 0. Okay, whenever this condition satisfies for x in range this, whenever this particular condition satisfies, that x square gets added to that value. Okay, so personal suggestion, avoid one liners if you are not too good at it, and else you can try it out. Complexity, at higher complexity, you can face problems. Now, this small exercise, say, list of all odd cubes. Okay, from 1 till 2197. Got it? Can you guys do list of all cubes? So list of all cubes, 2197 is okay. You can take a number, all odd cubes. So you will do this, x cross x, say x cross x, and then in range, say I'm giving it as 1 to 10, like 1 to 11, and then odd cubes, okay? If you just print it out, you see it's odd cubes are there. Fine. This is basically the same thing. The range is given to a higher range, okay? Remember this comprehension, like this shorthands gives you a rapid and programmatic generation of list, okay? To get this rapid and programmatic way, remember the mistakes are also rapid, like you can get mistakes too. So try it only when you are used to it, or as a new, like as a person who's starting with it, you can obviously try this. The next thing is the importing modules. Now, in the start, I have mentioned you something called you remember the NumPy, I have mentioned something called Pandas, I have mentioned something called Kinter. Okay, so these are actually modules in Python. This doesn't come under basic Python. Okay, so also there's a module called Math. When you're trying to do mathematical operations, say factorial, say this kind of thing, are you going to again and again use a say define a function or do it manually, or better use a function that's predefined, let's say times, right? The same is the here. If you want to try out factorial in this manner, the first example, it will give an error. Why? Factorial is not defined. Now you import the math, okay? And then there's a math library imported, and then you just print out the factorial file. Look, it works now. So where is factorial defined? It's defined in the module math. In the math module, there's an function called factorial. Why is the math module written? It's written within Python. It's not your idea, like it's not your task to figure out where it's written. As a normal programmer, you just can find out what it does. Okay, next thing, another way of implementing it is, well, our first way we just implemented is like import math, and then you write math.factorial. Also, you can do something of that sort, from math import factorial. Now you don't need to write math.factorial, you simply write factorial file, it will give you the output. Okay, that's how you actually do it. Got it. So that was what I was supposed to cover in this workshop today. And
so I'm going to start off with a very nice function or a feature built in for Python, which is help. So the best, if you forget about something in Python, you can just type help inside the shell and help function. And it will take you inside this interactive shell with help, and you can search for anything, like any function, any built-in functions, and it will tell you all the information about it. So for example, I'm going to type print, and it returned help on built-in function print in module built-ins. So the print function can take arguments like value and multiple values in this case. That's why there's triple dots and a separator, and end, file, and flush, and all the definitions of each arguments are given here. And this is built in function that you won't get anywhere in any other languages. It's a nice one. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Moving on with object oriented programming. So Python is a object-oriented programming language, like any other language, like in Java, C++, or JavaScript. And it allows us to develop applications using object-oriented approach. So we can easily create and use classes and objects. There are some major terms and principles, that is object, class, method, inheritance, polymorphism, data abstraction, encapsulation. These are very important for object orientation. First, object. Object is an entity that has state and behavior. It may be any real world object like the mouse, keyboard, chair, table, pen, etc. Everything in Python is an object, and almost everything has attributes and methods. all functions have a built-in attribute doc, which I'm going to talk later, which returns the doc string defined in the function source code. So what does that basically mean is anything in our real life world, there, everything is an object because it has some uniqueness in it. Your shoes, they are an object because it is uniquely made for you. Not every shoe is the same, even if it's made in the machines in the factories. And your laptop, it has a unique serial number, even though if your friend has the same laptop, but the serial number is different, but the model is same. So that's object. Yes. What is a class? Class can be defined as a collection of objects. It is a logical entity that has some specific attributes and methods. For example, if you have an employee class, then it should contain an attribute and method, and an email ID, name, age, salary, etc. So class, you can take it as a mold for object. It defines what an object is. Suppose every laptop is same because it has a foldable screen and a keyboard, a trackpad. So we can say a laptop class has several laptop objects, but that those laptop objects are unique from each other because like the my laptop is Acer branded and your laptop may be of HP and Dell and etc. So those are unique. But you see, every laptop has the same, you can say data, that is the brand, that is different from each other. So the attribute brand is same, but the data in it is different. So that what defines an object and a class. And why do we need this object-oriented programming? Because in procedural programming that you were just doing, that only contains a set of instructions and it just performs it. But with object orientation, you can solve real world problems with it, with programming. Achha. What is a method? Any function that is associated with an object, it is called a method. So in Java, every function is called method because it is a class oriented programming language. So if a function is inside a class, you can call it a method or an object. Okay, in Python, a method is not unique to a class instances. Any object type can have methods. Okay, what is inheritance? Inheritance is also a principle in object-oriented programming, which is that you can inherit another class. Suppose your dad has a job, and when your dad gets old, you inherit his job. That is sometimes called nepotism in Bollywood. So that is what is inheritance. You can inherit everything from that class and use it in your subclass. This is the definition. Inheritance is the most important aspect of object-oriented programming, which simulates the real-world concept of inheritance. It specifies that the child object acquires all the properties and behaviors of the parent object. By using inheritance, we can create a class which uses all the properties and behavior of another class. The new class is known as a derived class or child class, and one whose properties are acquired is known as a base class or parent class. It provides reusability of the code.
So we have a question.
Okay.
So in Python, everything is an object. Someone is asking.
Yes, like you were using list. So when you are making a list, and in Python programming language, it is built in. So it is behind the scenes. You really don't know about that. But when you use list.append, append is a method of class list. So that's how you can use. So whenever you are creating a list, it is a class. It is creating an object from the class list in Python.
Okay.
So is that clear? Ronak M. Please respond with a yes, so I can continue. Or never mind. So it provides reusability of the code. How? The classes can be modular, so we can decide when we want to use it or not. And we can just write it once and use it anywhere in our program. That is reusability for us. So there's another principle, polymorphism, which contains two words, poly and morphs. Poly means many and morphs means form, shape. By polymorphism, we understand that one task can be performed in different ways. For example, if you have a class animal, and all animals speak, but they speak differently. Here the speak behavior is polymorphic in the sense and depends on the animal.o. The abstract animal concept does not actually speak, but specific animals like dogs and cats have a concrete implementation of the action speak. Okay. Encapsulation is also an important aspect of object-oriented programming. It is used to restrict access to methods and variables. So if you want to keep things private in a class and don't want to give access to others, like you have passwords, so you can restrict the access to the password in a class. Okay, so nobody can modify it later. In encapsulation, code and data wrapped together within a single unit from being modified by accident. Okay, data as abstraction and encapsulation are both often used as synonyms, but both are nearly synonym because data abstraction is achieved through encapsulation. Abstraction is used to hide internal details like passwords and show only functionalities. Abstracting something means to give names to things so that the name captures the core of what a function or a whole program does. That's it for the definitions. Now I'm going to jump to some programming. Okay. Okay, so here I have my editor and I'm using VS Code. You can use anything. I'm going to create a new file, main.py, and just a simple class. We can name it animal.
Increase the font size, I think it will be visible to all. Yep.
Okay, so name. We can give it a name, something. So this is a class animal and I just gave it an attribute of name, which is lion. Okay. So I can just print animal. You can see here the output is lion. This is a simple example of class, the very basic, the very fundamental. But to apply it in our real programs, we have to modify it a bit. So I'm going to start with animal. And there's another thing in classes, that is constructor. So every time an object is created from a new class, so the constructor constructs the object with the instructions that it has. So init function defines the constructor. And it contains a built-in parameter, which is self. I'm going to tell you what it is. So I'm going to take the name of the animal. Okay. And anything else should I include? Respond me in the chat. What should an animal should have an attribute? Mm-hmm. How's animal name working? Don't we have to create an object of the animal class? In this case, no. We are that I assign the value to animal, that line. I'm going to show how to create an object from the class. Okay, that was very fundamental. Chitram Das Gupta. Okay, horns. Anything else? Mm-hmm. Let's say color tail.
Give it an age.
Age matters. So now I'm going to declare some member functions. So member of class animal. Okay, so whenever I'm going to create the object of animal, I'm going to give it some data, name, horns, tail, and age. Okay, so it will create the object according to that. So the member functions are declared like this, self.name. You can give it anything, just animal name. Okay. Whenever you are going to access something from the object, you are going to access the animal name. Not the name. Name is passed from the, when you are creating the object, it is passed from that, and then you are going to assign that name to animal name. And self.animal name means that animal name attribute is that member attribute of that class. Okay. So name. Self.horns equals to horns. Tail equals to tails. Self dot age equals to So both the variable that I'm passing and the variable that it is self.variable, both are different. Okay. Don't be confused by the names. You can keep the, you are always going to access the left side of the variables when you're going to access from the objects. Okay. So now I'm going to create an object, lion equals to animal. Going to give it a name, Sheru, no, Baghi. What's lion in Hindi? Respond me in the chats.
Sher.
So let's give it a name, Sheru. Horns, horns are, we can keep it a Boolean value. So if it has horns or not. Horns, false. Tail, true. Age, what should be the age of lion? Respond me in the chats. First. 5, okay. 5 months, years, dates, nothing, doesn't matter. Let's keep it a number. So right now we created a lion, which is an object of class animal. So how we are going to print it? Let's see. We can print lion dot animal name. This should work. You can see here that Sheru. Nice. Now I can put some conditions. I'm going to put some methods in our class. So def method can be has horns. And every time you define a new method, you're going to pass the self parameter in every method. So it can access all the variables or the attribute it has inside the class. Self.hasHorns. So I can just access it from there. Wait, not hasHorns, only horns. So what I'm going to do is put a condition, if self.horns, okay. If it is true, then print this animal self dot animal name has horns, else in self dot animal name not has horns. Okay. Now we can just call it like a regular function, has horns. Let's see. Sheru doesn't has horns. Nice. Horns tail share 5 years. No. Sad for Sheru. Let's create a buffalo. Animal. Can anyone name the buffalo in the chats? Any Jungle Book fans in here? Meanwhile, I'm just going to fill the rest of it. It has horns. Buffalo has horns, I guess. And it has a tail.
Okay, the name came in Buffy.
Buffy, okay. Nice, Titas. Nice joke. Okay, so the what should be the age? Let's keep it 45.
Months. Don't worry, guys.
Yeah. Now let's print buffalo dot has horns.
You can just call buffalo dot has horns. It is just printing. It doesn't return anything.
Yeah, Buffy has horns. Let's see. Okay. Now moving on. Let's do something more interesting. Okay, now I can just create objects from the terminal, so the user can do it. I'm going to create a list of objects, which is very popular in JavaScript, array of objects. Or yeah. So animal list equals to, now this is an empty list. Now, whenever a user creates an animal, it will be pushed, the object will be pushed inside the animal list. Okay. Not def, create animal. And we're going to, yes, print animal creation. So what are the inputs that we are going to take? This is name, horns, tail, and age. So first the name equals to stir input, enter the animal's name. Next it is horns. Horns equals to input plus the animal has input Okay. So I've taken all the inputs and now I'm going to create.
So I don't think we have explained the input function.
Yes, we haven't. So what input function basically does is it takes the raw input. Okay, so that's why I have put a stack. It's a call stack. It's called call stack. So first the input function will be called. Okay, so when the input function takes the input, it gives its input to the parameter of that outer function, which is in this case the name. It's str string. So
I was about to interrupt when you were there.
Okay. So do you want to interrupt me
still? You were already interrupted.
Explain that part.
Okay, it basically takes the raw input and then you can just convert it to your desired data type. Like I'm doing with it, the name will be taken input, then it will be converted to string, and the horns, tails will be converted to bool after taking the input, and the age after taking the input, it will be converted to integer. So that's what basically input does, and input can print the sentence, and after that it will take the input, whatever the user input is. Okay, so you can just see it in the example when I run it. Okay, moving ahead, now I'm going to create the animal, which is a new animal object. This is just a variable, and I'm going to call the animal class and pass all the variables to it, which is name, horns, tail. That's it. Then what I'm going to do is append the object to the animal list. So animal list dot append new animal object. That's it. So it will create a list whenever I create an animal. And then I'm just going to use recursion to call the create animal again and again. I'm going to call create.
Don't we need to stop the recursion at some point?
Yeah, coming to that, we can see the program can append the objects to the animal list, but how do we just see it? How do we know it? We have to write some code to print the animal list in a manner that we can see that animal is being created and appended to the list. Okay. Create animal is done. So I'm just going to create a menu. Animal manager. So you can be an animal manager if you know how to code in Python. And print. One is create animal. So these type of programs are called menu-driven programs. You can just select an option and it will do it for you. Two, display animals. Then I'm going to take the input. And if option one is selected, then it will just call the create animal function.
Interrupting again.
Yes.
Input is taken nowhere, like left option before it. Like int input enter option,
yeah,
before that a variable left option is needed.
Yes. So I have to store the option, like I said. So I stored the option to the option and then checked the option with the condition. And then I call create animal. If option equal to, then display animals. Okay, now I have to display the animals. Def display animals. Okay. So whenever this is called, I have to access the animal list in here. For x in animal in animal list print animal dot name. Okay, so I have to access the object and the attribute which is animal name. So animal dot animal name, then print, and I'm going to end it with a space. Okay. So then horns, print this print animal. Basically you are prompted for runtime input. Okay, animal dot horns. End it with a, okay, let's see if it works. And print animal name. I guess this should work. Let's see if any error arises and we can just fix it according to it. Okay. Now create animal. Invalid syntax. Animal. Okay, I forgot to get the brackets. Okay. Nano, it should work. After that, nano. Also, please note the indentations. Okay. Now, nothing is showing up because I have to call the menu function which I wrote earlier. So, I have to call it now. Let's see. You can see there is a menu now. Welcome to Animal Manager. There are two options, create animal and display animal, and enter option. Let's create some animals first. So animal creation, enter the animal's name, Sheru. Animals has horns, true. I have to input the Boolean values. If you want to take input as Y or N, then you have to use if else statements. So if the input is Y, then you have to put the Boolean as true. Okay. Oh, in case of Sheru, it will be false. It has a tail, true. Okay, and enter age. Five. Okay, so after the animal is created, I'm returned back to the menu. So you can see that in the program, after creation of the animal, I have called the menu function. So it takes you back to the menu. Okay, so this is how recursion works. And then I can just display the animal. Let's see, two. Okay, and you can see the animal name, which is Sheru, and true because it has horns. Okay. So, and this welcome to animal manager is coming because I have to put a new line after true, which I haven't. So that's a design problem. Let's create some more. Let's just fix this type and then create some more animals and display. Okay. So where is the problem? Animal name. Okay. Just going to keep it as name and then end as a new line. No. I'll just use a separator of and use multiple values like name and horns, has horns. Just let, and what do we have after that? Tail and age. I'm going to write tail, then age. And it will be separated with this string. And then I'm going to write end with a new line. Okay. This seems tidy. And then I'm going to print all the details of the animal now. I'll first the name, then I'm going to do it in one line. So the animal name will be printed first, then the animal dot, what's the horns, tails, and age. Okay, horns, animal dot tail, and animal dot age. That's it. And I'm going to use the same separator attribute, which is, sorry, parameter separator, and end it with a new line every time it prints a animal. Okay, I guess this should work. Is there anything that I'm missing? No. Okay, so I'm just going to give a new line so it looks cool. And it is very important that your program looks cool and your output looks cool, or nobody's going to look at it. Okay. Right, so let's just use the terminal now. I'm inside the animal manager, so let's create some animals. Now you can suggest me some new animals in the chat. Please do it. I'm waiting for you, guys. Suggest me an animal name.
Horse.
Horse, okay.
Yeah.
Does your horse has horns?
No.
So it will be false. And does it have a tail?
Yes.
Okay. And what is its age?
10.
Whatever 10 means. Okay, now I have a request from Shomik Chakraborty, which is leopard. Okay, leopard. Does your leopard has horns, Shomik?
In which dimension?
Well, anything is possible in your Python programs. So your leopard can have horns in your Python program. So it's true. And does it have a tail, Shomik?
How will it balance itself in?
Okay. So true. And what will be its age, Jomik? Cool. 3000. Okay. Anyone else would like to contribute to my great animal manager?
He's 25 though.
Okay, 25, then it was first up.
A dog.
Oh. Very loyal. Oh.
Okay.
I was supposed to enter the option. It's all right, not it's not a problem. Let's do it.
And the problem is
If I had done some error handling, okay, this wouldn't have happened. I'll show you next. Just, let me just fast forward. False, false, true, integer 5, leopard. I'm doing the same mistakes. It's okay. Let me just take a chill. Great animal. Animal's name was horse. True, 5. Then it was leopard, and it had horns, true. It had tails, true. And the it was 3000. Let's keep it 3000. Now, after that, dog. Your dog has horns, Shubham, Shubhankar. Hello, Shubhankar. Do you copy? So let's keep it true. And your dog doesn't have any tails, so it will be false. And what will be your dog's age? It would be
two.
Okay. Two sounds great. One. So I'm going to put an animal of my own, which would be humans are also animals. So
yeah.
Let's keep it human. Yes. True. Okay. They used to have a tail, but now it's hidden. So let's keep it false. But looks funny. And 150. Coronavirus. Yes. Now next going to be coronavirus. Okay. Everybody stay safe. Wash your hands. Does coronavirus have horns?
Yes. Yes. True.
It's true. That does it have tails? I
have horns. I am not getting
false. And what's the age?
2 months.
Why two? It's March 20th, so it was discovered in December, late December. So let's keep it four months. Okay.
Let's take a look.
So you can see from here the name horn tail edge. Horse true 5, and it was supposed to be a tabular form, but ignored my style. Yeah. These are all stored in the animal list. So yeah, I just accessed it from there.
That's the end to this video. Don't forget to hit the like button. Also subscribe the channel so that you don't miss any other video. Share this video with your friends and who also want to learn Python. Thank you. Hope to see you soon in my next video as well.